So I'd like to welcome everybody to our second panel of the day. This panel is called Artistamps and Their Makers, Seeing the World in Miniature. I have four people that I admire a huge, huge, huge amount, and I would like to take a moment to tell you a little bit about each of them, and then we'll sort of get into a conversation about their work, what they do, how they came to the world of Artistamps, what that means for them, particular themes, and that kind of thing. So I'll go ahead and we'll jump right in. So James Felter, to my left, in 1974, he curated the exhibition titled Artistamps and Stamp Images at the Simon Fraser University in Vancouver, Canada. It was the first exhibition of its kind, and it featured artist stamp makers from 35 different countries. The exhibition toured throughout Europe and the United States and brought a higher visibility to the artist stamp community. Throughout the 70s and 80s, James collaborated with various artist stamp makers in the mail art scene, including Buster Cleveland and E.F. Higgins, who is in the audience as well. I think he went outside to have a smoke.
He's the one clapping. Oh.
There he is right there. And Higgins is with us from New York, so that's fantastic. All right, let's see, in the 90s, James was instrumental. He was an instrumental part in the organization and curation of the International Invitational Artist Stamp Exhibit at the Davidson Gallery in Seattle. Today, James is actively engaged in the world of artist stamps, sending mailings via Postmar. Did I say that right?
That's fine.
Okay. How would you pronounce it?
Mrar.
And the Mrarvian High Commission. Yeah?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. All right, thank you. And then Harley is also with us today. In 1975, visual artist Harley created his own postal service, calling it the Tristan Local Post, and began issuing postage stamps in support of it. In 1978, Harley closed his Tristan Local Post and created his very own independent state with its own postage stamps. He named this land Terra Candela, which is loose Latin for land of light. And in 1987, Harley curated Corresponding Worlds, Artist Stamps at the Allen Memorial Art Museum in Oberlin College in Oberlin, Ohio, which is where his artist stamp archive now resides. And then my good friend James Klein. Let's see, founding postmaster for Black Rock City, in other words, Burning Man, James Klein has organized and facilitated thousands of pieces of outgoing mail. In his own artist stamp work, he often incorporates scenes from the playa, highlighting different artists and events which take place at Burning Man. Recently, James has played an active part in the Save the Berkeley Post Office movement. Let's see, I lost my place. Issuing a commemorative artist stamp sheet with collaborator James Munday. He's been active in the mail art and rubber stamp community since the 70s. And then many of you in the audience know Ginny Lloyd. Yay! Hi, Ginny! Hello! Your fans are here, Ginny. They love you. So she gets a little bit of a delay because we're talking via Skype. So if you guys have questions for Ginny, we'll have to talk a little slow, okay? As you know, Ginny publishes numerous books related to correspondence art and artist stamps under the imprint Trapichacha Press. While living in San Francisco in the 70s, she joined up with the Bay Area Dadaists, meeting artists and collaborators such as Bill Gaglione and Anna Banana. In 1984, Ginny was one of the organizers of InterDada 84, a mail art congress which took place in various venues throughout San Francisco, and which led to an even deeper involvement on her part with the mail art scene. Currently, she maintains the Gina Lotta Post Archive in Jupiter, Florida, and as I mentioned, she's here via Skype, so we can see her right there, which is exciting. So I thought that I would jump right in with our guests, because I just have some questions, and I'm sure that the audience will have questions for you as well. And so I'd love to hear a little bit about how each of you got involved in making artist stamps, because it's this sort of offshoot of mail art that sometimes people fall in love with immediately, or they're a little bewildered by it. Like, what is that and how could you do it? So I'd love to hear background from each of you, how you became involved.
You want me to start?
Oh, sure.
Well, it's a very specific question about getting a starting in artist stamps. So, but I'll do a little runaround. As a teenager, I was a stamp collector. My father bought me a small stamp collection book, and I ended up buying the world global volumes, you know, two or three, and I collected the world, and I couldn't specialize on anything, and I kept collecting stamps until I went to university. In 1957, I actually started designing my own first day covers, doing collages. So I consider those my first mail art. Of course, I didn't know what mail art was. I don't think mail art existed in those days. But I still have two of them, so they're in my archives. Then I went to the University of South Florida, where I graduated in fine art, specializing in painting. But in those days, we considered ourselves visual artists, not painters or whatever. Then I went to South America, and I was there from 65 and 66, when North American culture went through a revolution. The pill came out, and LSD came out. Two pills that changed the world.
Exactly.
And I came back and immigrated to Seattle. I had grown up in New York and went to university in Florida, went to South America, and didn't want to go to California, so I ended up in Seattle. On Lake Union, getting stoned on acid. Then the following year, I went to Vancouver, British Columbia, and started working in the Center for Communication and the Arts at Simon Fraser University. And the man who hired me was an American artist named Joel Smith. And he painted on postage stamps. And that got me excited about stamps again.
Did he use oil or watercolor?
Yes. I think he was using acrylic in those days. You know.
Okay.
And of course, and I did the smallest documented exhibition in the world of one of his stamps on a stage set in the foyer of the theater. And that we had a poster this big, and the art was this big,
yeah.
And it was in the center.
Yeah.
And those posters are very hard to come by. That was my first experience in doing what I consider now an artist stamp.
Yeah.
Then I went to Montreal because I was the curator of the gallery then, and I was looking for art. And I went to La Guilde Graphique, which is a printmaking workshop. And a guy there had done a book called The Dead Letters. And in the book, he had inserted a sheet of stamps, maybe three across and six down, small sheet, called the Dead Letter Stamps. And I thought, oh gosh, I have to have those. So I actually bought the sheet of stamps. I didn't buy the book, but he sold me the sheet of stamps. Came back to Vancouver, and then one day who appears in the gallery but Robert Fried from San Francisco. And he'd been coming up to do covers for the alternative newspaper, which was in those days the alternative newspaper called the Georgia Strait. He was doing covers for them. And he had these very, very large offset, full color, perforated sheets of stamps called the non-negotiable eights. And he also had serigraph prints, which with embossed perforations, not holes, but embossing to simulate the perforations. And I managed to force the acquisitions committee to buy them for the university collection. And he came through several times, and Dana actually came through one day. Ken Friedman came through one day, and I was thinking, now there's an artist in California, there's an artist in Montreal, and one in Vancouver working with the stamp image. I thought, how many more are there? So I asked Dana and I asked Ken, you know, to send me addresses and names, and then I found out about Fluxus and Ray Johnson and Robert Watts and everything in New York, and I found out about the Art Workers Newsletter in New York, so I wrote an ad that was published in the Art Workers Newsletter. And for about 2 years, I gathered information. There was another artist in Canada, Christopher Pratt, who did large serigraph prints of Newfoundland stamps. So there was no artist stamps. There was artists' stamps, two words, and then images of artist stamps. So that's why the title of the book was of the exhibition was so much. When Ken Friedman came through again, and we sort of talking about it, and sort of I finally set the date for the show, which was October of 1974, and it will be the 40th anniversary in October.
Wow.
So it's 40 years I've been collecting information about artist stamps and all that stuff. I asked Ken to design the commemorative stamp, and Ken being Ken sent me two logos and said, here, use these. So I designed the stamp and put his logos on them and claimed it was his. And he eventually renounced it because he didn't like the curve on the corner. But he did sign them all. And that's also, I did my sheet of stamps, my first one for the exhibit, because I always considered myself a visual artist more than a curator. I just happened to be making my money as a curator. Couldn't make it as a visual artist. So my stamp was a Canadada stamp with a maize maple leaf, and it commemorated the year I became a Canadian citizen, 1974. So I'm a dual citizen now. So that was the beginning of my sort of introduction into mail art and artist stamps and everything else. And we printed a photocopied catalog. I designed it as a real stamp collector's catalog, but we couldn't afford to publish it. So I photocopied some and mailed them out. Mm-hmm. And some of you got information about the show and started contacting me. And then the more work was added. Carl Chews were added after the first initial one. I think Anna Bananas were added. Dana Ashley was already in the show. He did some altered stamps.
And this was the show in 74?
This was the show in 74.
And that...
No, this was after the initial showing.
Oh, I see. Okay.
When that catalog was distributed.
Okay.
And then I began to hear about other artists because I didn't know Ed Higgins found out about it and called me from Colorado. And so he sent me sheets. And because it was traveling, I added.
Right, as it went.
Right. And 2 years later, I received a grant from the Canada Council to publish the catalog.
I see.
So some of those artists that were added from the initial one got added to the catalog. And also the Kerner Foundation in Vancouver, we discovered, had money they had to get rid of.
Wouldn't that be nice?
So and they needed grant applications right away. So I applied for a grant, and I got 2/3 of the artist's value of the stamps, because I had them send in the value of the stamps, and because we had, you know, we were borrowing them.
Right.
It wasn't a mail art show.
I see.
Right? It was a gallery show. Huh. I didn't know about mail art shows then. So I wrote all of the artists and said, would you accept 2/3 of the value that you originally stated? And one of the artists was Donald Evans.
Wow.
I had been in touch with him, and he sent me a couple of sheets and designed a special sheet for Simon Fraser University.
And for those of you who don't know the work of Donald Evans, he did these beautiful watercolor stamps on a whole different range of subject matter, often dealing with nature and like oceanscapes beautiful work.
See,
his own countries, yeah. Right.
So he wasn't really, I didn't restrict it to mail art. It was artists who worked with the stamp image, right? Either with prints or watercolors or drawings or whatever. And the reason I did that is because I didn't know if I could find enough real perforated stamps at that time. But since then, they've all been dealing with that material.
Yeah.
Okay, does that answer that question?
Let Harley talk a little bit. Okay. So, Harley, tell me how you got into artist stamps.
Well, I have to ask you something first. I don't recall being asked how much my stamps were worth.
Well, you had to fill out a form. You filled out a form.
I did?
Yes, you did. I didn't take anything without a form.
We'll talk about it later. My descent into philatelic and artist stamp hell began at an early age. And we have to blame Tommy Babs, the little fat boy who was in my third grade class. And he came to show and tell one day, and he had a Ritz cracker box, and he opened it up, and all of these World War II era Japanese stamps fell out.
Wow.
And I can still see them because I'm sick. And I was mesmerized, and also probably questioning why he got so much attention. But anyway, so I became enthralled with stamps, and that manifests itself by going to the library and looking in the National Geographic and finding not just the naked pictures, but really obscure Tokelau Islands, Tristan da Cunha, Pitcairn, obscure places, and I started writing letters to postmasters and people on these islands, and I got really great mail.
So they actually replied back to you?
Yeah. I had the big man Gordon Glass on Tristan da Cunha, which had at that time 200 and some occupants until it blew up in 63 or something. You know, we corresponded for a long time. Anyway, so we went on in this with the stamp business, and then I'm a painter and a collagist by profession, and so it was only natural those two things would come together. But from a philatelic point of view, in philately, there are local posts, and local posts, private enterprises that preceded the establishment of government hegemony over the postal system. So I made a local post, originally Tristan Local Post. My son's named Tristan, he was named after Tristan da Cunha. So I had Tristan Local Post. And I, like Carl, had a couple entertaining visits from postal inspectors. The second one wore a gun. So the postmaster came around. It was one of the last of the pork barrel appointees. It's a 1940s term, political appointees, I guess. And he sat in the corner and read a comic book belonging to my son. And I talked to the other man, and I spread everything out. And I said, well, I can explain this to you. They were concerned about my stamps, which had a charcoal self-portrait, which in no way resembled any current U.S. postage stamp. And I said, I can explain it from a philatelic point of view or from an art history point of view. And he continued to look totally blank. And so I said, when you find someone in your huge organization who knows what I'm talking about, send them over. They took umbrage at all that. But anyway.
And did they take the stamps as well?
No.
No? They gave them back?
No. No, they just came because they were seeing my mail coming in to Oberlin, little post office, and they got hysterical. And, you know, I have no idea. It's all stupid.
Yeah, what year was that?
Tristan Local Post was like early to mid-70s.
Okay.
Because we come to the next chapter. The late, great Ellen Johnson, the doyen of art historians at Oberlin College, a really crotchety woman, came in one day and slapped down this thing, and she said, I don't know what this is, but I know you like stamps. And it was Jimmy's do over here. It was the catalog, and I thought, well, oh my God, because there was nothing in any of the art press on artist stamps, mail art. Absolutely nothing. You know, I was right in the forefront of nerds. And so I bundled up my stuff. I do want to see that paper I saw. I bundled up my stuff and sent it off to Felter, and you put it in sometime, apparently. Mm-hmm. And then when I sold my archive, we'll talk about that in a minute, to Oberlin College, I had work by over 1,200 artists. So in the interim, I was very busy corresponding with people. So, and then I organized Corresponding Worlds, which, when was that? 84, 85. I fought through three museum directors. Any of you have gone through that, you'll know what I mean. and they were terrified because Oberlin's a small snot college in northern Ohio. And the museum is very, very nice, has a beautiful collection. And it was, I think, if not the first, but really one of the first museum presentations of mail art and artist stamps. And so I had to fight these people tooth and nail to get it through, and they were horrified. And I explained to them that no, they couldn't curate the exhibit because it all belonged to me, and if they did, I'd cancel the whole thing. So, and I managed to squeeze out of the budget flying in about 10 artists, right?
I didn't go.
I know you didn't go. And
but yes, I think you did.
Yeah, yeah.
I know all about it.
Yeah.
The expert.
I know. Judith Hofburg was there. There was a lack of women due only to the fact that most of the people I knew were males. I tried to bring in artists geographically. I brought in John. And who else was there? I brought in Higgins. Yeah.
Ed Varney.
Chuck Welch. Cracker Jack Kid mm-hmm. came. Anyway,
Joel came, didn't he?
I think so. Dogfish was there. I first met Dogfish, Robert Rudin, and Cracker Jack Kid, and I do want to mention this man's name. He was a dear soul, Michael Bidner.
Yeah.
He's the one who coined the term artist stamps.
Artist stamp, putting it together. He had the first real bringing together from a philatelic point of view and an artist stamp point of view, bringing those two things together. And we all met in London, Ontario, and we had a terrific time. Mm-hmm. And that's when I first met Robbie mm-hmm. and Cracker Jack. Mm-hmm. So, and I've curated some other shows. I've been real pissy about it because I want it to be understood as an art form. And I'm all for democracy and the ecumenical. I err on that sometimes. But I want it viewed as an art form, not a sideline. And of course, in France, for instance, the National Postal Museum has a whole room full of artist stamps.
And often put out publications that are devoted specifically to artist stamps.
Yeah, yeah. So we'd like to see that happen here. And unlike Mr. Darling, I didn't declare my total non-interest in income, but I think an artist's lot in this culture generally turns out like that. So, but I'm still here, and I'm still making stamps, and will do until, you know, the final.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Let's have James talk a little bit, the other James Klein, about his work that he does with Burning Man.
Burning Man stuff.
Yeah.
Just briefly, show of hands, how many people don't know what the Burning Man Festival is? Just a few. Okay.
How many people have been to Burning Man in the room?
Yeah.
A few. Okay, that's great.
Burners. Sure. That better?
Yeah, because then good. Jenny can hear you too.
Okay, well, this is just very briefly. The Burning Man Festival started in San Francisco with people going to Baker Beach and burning the big effigy of a man made out of wood while they played musical instruments and smoke pot, probably, and a few things like that. The event got so popular and grew so quickly that the city of San Francisco wouldn't allow it anymore, and it moved to the Black Rock Desert in Nevada. And it's grown to about 60,000 people now. And it's a week of...
Sorry to interrupt. The starting year of Burning Man was?
I don't know exactly. Middle 80s?
Yeah, okay.
Say, something like that. So, speaking as an art school dropout, I went into other fields, but I kept my love of art and imagery by using rubber stamps and communicating with friends with decorated envelopes and started finding other people who are doing the same thing. Through this publication, which no longer exists, sadly, Global Mail, some of you may remember this, there was a listing of all kinds of art projects, male artists, convicts looking for pen pals, you name it. anybody who used paper and pencil or crayon. And I found a friend in there, Julie Peasley, who was living in Colorado. I live in Berkeley. And we got together, and when she moved out to the Bay Area, we decided to go up to Burning Man together. And we did that in 1996. The first time you go to Burning Man is like taking acid the first time. It just can't be described. And there were only 8,000 people at that time. So one of the features of Burning Man is that it's a gift economy. You're supposed to bring something to share, whether it's a performance, a service, giving a massage, opening a bar and giving free drinks, making coffee, cooking sandwiches, whatever. And the other aspect of it is that it's completely non-commercial. There's nothing for sale except coffee, tea, and ice. And you can't imagine how refreshing that is to be somewhere where someone isn't trying to sell you a t-shirt, a hat, something. So we decided that for our gift, for the next year that we went up, we would share mail art. And so we decided to open a little post office. And some other friends of mine came along. One fellow was a neon sign guy, and he'd been collecting salvaged bits of neon signs for years. And so he brought enough letters to spell post office in mismatched letters, mismatched colors, mismatched fonts. Yeah. And we built an open counter, pretty much like this. Another fellow brought a printing press. And in the meantime, we had taken photographs captured in 1996, turned them into a sheet of stamps, which were perforated by John Held for us. And we handed those out, fastened onto envelopes with some rubber stamped statements on them. And it was wildly successful. People were just standing in line waiting for these things. In addition, we designed a sort of emotive card, and people were supposed to take this and write down something that made them happy, sad, mad, whatever, confess. We collected those and put them inside the Burning Man, so they were burned up.
Wow.
Huh. That was sort of a nice gesture. Yeah. So this was also incredibly popular that they moved the camp, our camp, it's a theme camp. Burning Man is organized around groups of people who come up there with a common idea and create a theme camp. So they moved our theme camp into center camp, and it's become sort of a utility, almost like a real post office. In past years, they got the approval of a cancellation with the local postmistress at Gerlach, Nevada, and now the cancellation that goes out on that mail is the only cancellation that comes out of Burning Man. And 2 years ago, they processed about 20,000 pieces of mail.
Incredible.
So the postmistress of Gerlach, Nevada has a job on her hands for about 1 week of the year.
Does she love you or hate you?
She likes us.
Okay.
We give her things. We make sure she has stuff.
Wow, okay.
Swag.
20,000 pieces of mail.
And so every year after that, we've created stamps. They carry usually photographic images from the year before. Mm-hmm. And we have people who are in the stamps come to get pictures of themselves in the stamps the next year. Mm-hmm. So I had some of these out at the postal window the other night when I was abusing you.
Oh, right. So if any of you were at the opening reception on Friday night for the Mail Art Book Show at the San Francisco Center for the Book, James was our postmaster for that evening. So that's a little added note for you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I brought some stamps, and at the reception I'll have some samples that you can have if you tear a panel off the sheets so that you get a copy of each type. I don't know if there's enough for everybody, but get in their elbows and feet, kick and try. So that's how I got into artist stamps and still produce them. So I guess that's cool. About it.
Do you have a favorite stamp sheet that you've done from Burning Man?
The first one was really nice.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you still have sheets of it?
I have a sheet and I make copies. And one nice thing about it is that there's a flaw. When I composed it, I didn't get the size of the stamps vertically just right, so that part of the printing is cut off. So thus it become highly valuable.
I know. I know.
Irregulars.
Artist proof. Right. Yeah, exactly. Thank you, James.
Thank you.
Now we'll. Yeah. Now we'll try and get Jenny Lloyd to come into the conversation. I'm hoping that she can hear me loud and clear.
The question is, how did you initially learn about Artistamps or get involved in Artistamps?
Yeah, can you tell us a little bit about that, as well as your work that you do with the Gina Lotta Postal Archive?
Okay.
Great.
Well, I started out it started out by hanging out with some arty friends in college. I wasn't an art major, but my electives were all art, and I was hanging out with them, and they were talking about, and they were sophisticated New York City folks, right? So they'd come back after a weekend or so telling me about the shows that they had seen, and they'd also talk about Fluxus and some of the Fluxus events because they were fans of Fluxus. So I got interested in Fluxus and found out about Robert Watts doing the sheets of stamps and doing the parody on the postal system. And it interests me because I had been a collector of stamps since a child, you know, the back of a comic book where you'd send away for the stamps. Well, I did that all the time. And then later on, I became a first day cover collector with the postal system. Mm-hmm. But anyway, when I found out that other people, that Robert Watts was doing stamps, I was like, oh, artists are doing stamps. So right around that same time, I came to San Francisco and ended up going to the Noe Valley Street Fair. Yay, Noe Valley. And I met Anna Banana and Bill Gaglione. Anna was dressed up as a banana on roller skate.
Imagine that.
Imagine that. And we became friends, and I would go over and help with assembling. They had various rubber stamp projects and assemblings and things like that. And I was working with a company that was copy machines.
Uh-huh.
So I started to see all this copy art and ended up organizing a show called the Copy Art Exhibition. Mm-hmm. In order for that show to succeed, they introduced me to Buster Cleveland, who knew a lot of people that were doing stamps or copy art, and Anna and Bill, and between the three of them, and just notices in Art Week newspaper, we had a big show. And it was held at La Mamelle. Is Nancy still in the audience?
Is Nancy in the audience? She's raising her hand for you, Jenny.
Yeah.
And she's saying hello and giving you a
big exhibition of copy art. And in that show were a lot of Artistamps. And that was my first exposure to really a variety of Artistamps. Mm-hmm. There was work from Higgins and Chu and Cleveland and Beelman and Banana and Pavel Petsatz and Spiegelman, mm-hmm, and James Klein, Scarlatina Lust, Banana Fish or Captain Biology, mm-hmm, just to name a few of the people that were participating in that show. Mm-hmm. And I was intrigued by the variety and got really inspired to do my own. Up until then, I had only made photo stamps that you would send away. I think it was Oshkosh magazine or Miles Kimball magazine, something like that, where you could send away and get your photo turned into stamps. And that was my only exposure to making my own stamps. So when I saw these incredibly beautiful prints, I had to give a try. So that got me interested in the stamp production of my own. And then I ended up having a storefront south of Market for a year. And what I think it was either the first or second show was an Artistamps show. Mm-hmm. And I got a pile of Artistamps that came in for my own collection. So over the years, I made stamps and I traded with people and created my own collection of stamps, which has now turned into the Gina Lotta Post Artistamps Museum. Should I talk a little bit about the museum?
You know what? Let me ask you a question. Anna mentioned earlier that she slept on your floor in that storefront on 6th Street. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
On 6th Ave. So it's a true story.
Yeah,
6th Street, 6th Ave. Okay.
That it was, what was the question about it?
I was just curious, and I wanted to know what kind of artwork you put in your window when you had that space.
In the storefront, I had a window, and it was a live-work studio for me. And then I had a window, and I had performances as well as exhibitions in the window. Mm-hmm. And it changed once a month. And we would have incredible openings, you know, for the people who were exhibiting and doing performances live in the window. Mm-hmm. And got a lot of attention from, you know, people with a crowd standing out on the sidewalk at the openings.
That's funny because it reminds me of a similar thing that was going on in Portland in the late 80s and early 90s called the Church of Elvis, which some of you might know. Yeah, hands waving in the audience.
Right. Nice. Awesome. And I actually had a mail art show at this space called the James Dean Mail Art Show during that year as mm-hmm. well. Mm-hmm. And which was quite popular. That was a big show. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I did Interdata 84 after
right.
that.
right.
And there was a huge exhibition of mail art during that particular week-long event.
Uh-huh. I guess I'd like to ask the group in general here, do you have a favorite sort of, if you could design any stamp for the U.S. Postal Service, what would it be?
I don't have a favorite.
You don't have a favorite?
Me.
Yeah, what?
Me.
You'd commemorate yourself on a
yes,
stamp?
Of course.
Oh, all right. Oh. Fair. Harley, what do you think?
Thank you for saving me the trouble.
What do you think, James? What would you design for the USPS?
Oh, boy. Something so beautiful it could save itself. People would just have to buy it. And the coffers would fill in the post office, and we'd all be happy again.
Nice.
Ryan, one of our members of the Correspondence Co-op in San Francisco, was telling me yesterday that the rates have gone up on postage in Canada so high that mail artists are thinking about stopping, that they can't really afford to keep doing it.
There's also a proposal right now before Parliament, I think, to ban home delivery in Canada.
Wow.
You mentioned that.
Wow. So that's a great question, since we have a Canadian on our panel. I mean, how are mail artists reacting to this huge rate increase in Canada?
Well, I make my own Christmas cards.
Mm-hmm.
I consider that a form of mail art. And I sent over 100 this year. And I figure I don't care how much it costs. It's worth getting something into the hands of your friends mm-hmm. that you've had over the years. And if it costs $1, $2, $3 to mail it, I mean, international postage is quite expensive.
Yeah.
Wow.
I'm willing to do it at least once a year.
All right. How do you guys feel about the 49-cent rate increase recently?
It's fine. It's still one of the cheapest prices in the world.
Absolutely.
Sure.
It's the Congress and not dealing with postal problems.
Mm-hmm.
So it's political stuff.
I agree. Oh, lean forward because no one can hear you.
Oh,
yeah.
It's political, it's Congress.
Well.
Yeah, for the privilege of having someone carry an actual artifact that you've created, whether it's a letter or mail art, whatever, to somebody else for 49 cents anywhere within the United States or the U.S., the APO, the military postal system, for the mm-hmm. same price, is amazing.
Yeah.
It's just great.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I had another idea. It seems to me like if some large corporation like Starbucks or something like that could get together with the post office and identify the post office buildings that are not being used, that they deem surplus real estate, that have big lobbies, say. Why couldn't we have a community gathering place that's the old-fashioned post office and the coffee house? Put them together.
Right.
Good idea.
Yeah, I love it.
Cool. Make a stamp for it.
There is hope. Guy Bleu, a wonderful artist in Belgium, was asked by the Belgian government to design a real postage stamp commemorating mail art, and he did.
And that was recently, yeah?
Not that many years ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I know that the question that everyone in the audience has for all of you, can you talk a little bit about the perforating?
First perforation was from John Held for that first year of Burning Man stamps, as I mentioned. And I was taken with that machine. I thought, wow, this is so cool. So I have a friend. I was living in San Luis Obispo at the time, and I have a friend who's really good at finding stuff. And he's a good guy, a machinist, and does all kinds of things, despite the fact that he's in a wheelchair. And I said, I've got a challenge for you. Can you find me a perforator? And after I'd established with him what it was, he called me back within a week and said, got one.
Whoa.
So I said, okay, where is it? And he says, oh, it's down here in a barn. Let's go get it. So I drove down there, and I had a pickup truck at the time. And we went in. Here's this barn, I guess. The roof was caved in. Water was everywhere. And I thought, oh, this is going to be a wreck. But in a dry corner, here's a perforator. I was expecting something like John's, a nice little tabletop Rossbach.
Yeah.
This thing is a south width. It's about 4.5 feet tall at the top part. It'll perforate 30 inches straight, and
Whoa.
It weighs about 400 pounds.
Holy moly.
And how much was it?
And how much was it?
25 cents a pound.
Uh-oh.
Last year, I just bought an electric Rossbach perforator. That was in the oldest Chinese printing shop in Canada, which happened to be 3 blocks from my home.
That's
amazing.
It
still cost me $200 to get it moved, and I paid $700 for the perforator.
Whoa.
But that's Canadian dollars.
And it's electric, let me tell you. Yeah.
Can I talk about the perforator I have?
Yes.
Sure, yeah, because that's important to the weekend, I think.
I had a Rossbach perforator, but it was so heavy I ended up selling it when I moved to Florida. But now I have a beautiful tabletop monitor perforator from Patricia Tavner's estate.
Yeah.
And let me tell you, having this portable, easy to move perforator is a dream compared to what I had to go through with that huge monster of a Rossbach perforator.
Have you perforated anything with it yet?
Oh, well, you've got my back sheets.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. So I've done a bunch already on that, and I found a couple other things to do with it. So I'm having fun.
So it's gone to a good home.
Yes.
And did you, did it get trucked to you?
It got
like freighted shipped. Because they're so heavy.
It was. But, you know, a strong man can pick it up. What can I say?
I have a word on perforators myself. Out here, Jenny?
Great, sorry.
Yeah. I have a rotary Rossbach perforator, which is how I am able to produce the International Art Post editions of 500 to 1,000 to 1,500. And I have, at this point, only 5 perf wheels. And below the wheels are the dies.
Right.
And so it means that every edition I produce has to go through the machine 4 times in order to do the 10 rows or whatever it is on the perforation. I got mine with Ed Barney initially from Vancouver Bookbinders, but then Ed left it sitting under his deck for a while, and I went, I gotta have this. He said, well, I don't really want it. So I bought it off him. I mean, I think we paid $50 or something for it. It probably cost us $200 or so to move it.
Yeah.
But I now have it running, and it's a dream.
Wow. And it's electric, too?
It's electric. It's motorized. So I basically, it's hand-fed.
Right.
You know, each sheet goes through it. You three or four sheets at a time. But anyway, on the subject of perforators, I could not remain silent.
Nor should you. Well, I guess I want to ask our guests if they have any sort of like last or parting comments about artist stamps, and then we'll take questions from the audience, if everyone's fine with that. You know, I guess in your own work, do you look for any sort of, do you deal with any specific subject matter or themes ever?
Well, I think most of us issue our own entities, stamps from our own entities, and mine will deal with maybe a topical subject of the day, something in the news. I did one for 9/11. I did one when Diane died. I've also done some with my own art, and I've done some with art from South America. And it's whatever moves me that day.
Yeah, I love that. Harley?
I do very few. I mean, most of them are from collages or paintings of my own work. Every once in a while, if I'm in a pissy mood, I'll do something political. I did things for the Axis of Evil book. I don't like confusing the two things. I think beauty sort of justifies its own existence. Not that I'm not aware of all the other stuff going on.
Thank you. James.
Most of the imagery that I have is from Burning Man, so the stamp sheets have Burning Man images. When I'm doing other things, I try to make them humorous or nice, beautiful in a way. For Christmas cards, occasionally I've taken florals and made stamps from those. And then combining things in unexpected ways. I took a little action figure of Frankenstein and a much shorter one of Donald Duck and put them together so that they looked like they were dancing and called it It Takes Two. So it was a denomination of two.
Yeah. Ginny, what about you? When you design artist stamps, what sort of imagery and theme do you work with?
I think I'm understanding your question, so I'll answer it and you can tell me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, sure enough.
My interest in arty stamp design has been in computer graphics and creating them on the computer from the very beginning. And I started out with as a tester of a computer graphic program color that was not on the market, but ended up as in the weather service.
Oh, wow.
The real-time weather, satellite weather graphics. Uh-huh. That was the forerunner to that. But that was back in 1980, something like that. But I've been interested, and then I taught computer graphics at Ohlone. So my source of inspiration has always been, what can I do on the computer? And also, I'm a photographer from way back. So anything that's turning a photograph into a stamp is also something that I really enjoy doing.
Wow, thank you. That's a great answer. I think now I'd like to take some questions from the audience.
James Klein talked about the story of turning an artist's post office at Burning Man into a real, legitimate, government officialized post office. And so my question for all of you is, has there ever been an artist stamp that has been turned into an official government-sanctioned postal service stamp?
I don't know of
I don't know.
The only examples I know are in Europe where the government has actually asked an artist who does stamps to do one that would be official, but it hasn't been created ahead of time. So I don't think any government would authorize or authenticate an existing one.
Yeah.
Another thing that's happened is that most postal systems are issuing stamps that are official stamps, but you can insert your own image. Right. When they first started that in this country, one of the print your own postage things, someone slipped in a baby picture of Adolf Hitler, and someone in the government was astute enough to know that. So now they, you know, they peruse to see that it's all dogs and things.
Kittens. What were you going to say, James?
I was going to say that I have something that add to this kind of peripherally, and don't try this at home, but some of the people who've gotten our Burning Man stamps have put them on as the only stamp on an envelope, and it has worked.
Yeah. Well, and Michael Thompson does that quite a bit from Chicago.
Yes.
So.
Yeah. But it's not a big deal because no one sees your mail, just machines. No, I know what you're talking about, but I mean, letters have been mailed with, we won't even go into what they've been mailed with, but no one sees the mail. It does get triggered in sorting machines if it doesn't have phosphor coating on it, which is what they use to flip the letter over so the cancel hits the stamp. But there are lots of letters that get through that, you know, don't have legitimate postage stamps. But that's when you meet the postal inspector.
Your new friends. Another question.
How would you encourage people who find they want to do work in artist stamps that they may not even have, say, a visual art background, but they're really interested in trying to get started and do their own? What, you know, to the whole group, what would you say to encourage people to do that?
Advice for newcomers.
I started with collages, actually. It was easier. It was easy. And you can take other images and cut them up and, you know, make a thing. And then you can actually reduce it photographically to make a little small one. Mm-hmm. So that's one idea.
Great advice. Anyone else?
Well, the computers, I don't do any of it. But the computer has all these programs where you can, you know, cut and paste. Not like we cut and paste in my day, but cut and paste. On different programs, and you can, you know, come up with a zillion stamp images. And then, you know, all the printing shops, or you can print them yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you don't have one of these zillion-dollar perforators, like my fellow compatriots up here, you call John or Jenny.
Other questions? Back in the back.
Regarding the cost of postage, it's possible to lock in your cost of postage for the rest of your life at 49 cents by buying forever stamps. And at the rate that the post office is raising rates, you'll probably get a better return on your money than putting it in any mutual fund or stock.
Yeah.
Dee is right about that.
But you don't get to buy any new stamps.
Yeah.
One point to make.
Yeah. James has a point that he'd like to make.
I just want to go back to Joel Smith, who was one of the first artists that I met who painted on stamps. Mm-hmm. And I asked him why he did this, you know. And he said, well, I can have a whole museum in my wallet.
That is such a beautiful statement.
And if there's a war, I can sneak it across the border very easily.
It's like Filiu carrying his art gallery in his, like, in the top of his cap.
Right.
And he'd take his cap off and show it. Yeah, exactly. That's so beautiful.
Yes.
Love it. I want to thank everybody for coming. I want to thank my panelists so much. And I'd also like to invite each and every single one of you to the reception that we'll be having for these fantastic folks.